As a parenting coach, I get to talk to a lot of troubled teenagers. About 6 years ago, I had a really interesting conversation with a 16-year-old girl. I was on the phone. This is me with the phone, by the way. And it was a coaching session. It was on a Monday. So I said, "Hi, sweetie, how you doing?" And she says, "Oh, I'm doing okay." I said, "That's good. How was your weekend?" She said, "It was okay. I partied and the usual, drank a bit, and I met a new guy." "Oh, what's he like?" "He's okay. I didn't really like him that much, so I wouldn't let him kiss me." "Good for you. I'm really proud of you." "So I just gave him a blowjob instead." True story. True story. I always say that I can never be shocked because I always say I've heard everything. That was the first time I'd ever heard anything quite like that. And I was really glad it wasn't Skype and she didn't see my reaction because... It's really good when you work from home. You don't care what you look like, so... I don't like it when a client says, "Can we do a video Skype?" I'm, "No, geez." Anyway, okay, now she... This young girl was right at the start of the hookup culture. And it progressed, it got worse and worse. And shortly after I talked to her, now I thought maybe she was just a one-off, but shortly after talking to her, I talked to a 14-year-old boy. And he said he was at a party, and they were drinking, and there was all these kids there, and he had shared his drink with this girl. And he said, and afterwards, she wouldn't give me a blowjob. So now I had experience with this now, so I said, "Oh, what a bitch." I admit, okay, that's not what I said, but... And then I thought, how did we get here? Like, what is going on? Am I that old that everyone else knows what's going on and it's just me? But no, of course not. So I thought, let's go back in time to when I was a little girl. This is not me. And I figure she probably wasn't getting much action even back then. That was the style. Back in the 60s, it was all about parenting, and that this is where the changes really started to happen. The 60s, mums generally didn't work. That was the norm. All mums were home, and every house had a mum in it. She had an apron, she was baking, she was gardening, all that stereo. She always had curlers in her hair, too. Does anyone else remember that? They never seemed to go anywhere, but they just had curlers in their hair all day long. They'd be gardening with their curlers. But the thing is, us kids were watched. Every parent knew every kid in the neighborhood, and they thought nothing on tattling on us. They'd phone up, "Dorothy, do you know what your little girl's doing?" And we'd get a whack on the butt with a rolling pin. We were looked after. We were watched. And the schools were disciplining us, too. We'd get a ruler on the hand or a belt on the butt. I'm not saying it's good, but it was something. So kids respected adults as a result of this. Let's go to the 70s now. It's interesting, the reason I chose these pictures is we all thought we looked like the one on the left. Reality, we looked like the one on the right. So we tried, we really tried. This was my teenage decade. So the 70s, there was a big shift here now. A lot of moms started going back to work. Now with that, when she did get home after work, she was more tired, right? She'd been at work all day, she didn't have the energy for the kids. The term latchkey kids started coming in. So kids were coming home with a key. They were letting themselves in, eating Twinkies, sitting on the couch, watching I Dream of Jeannie or whatever, Brady Bunch probably. So kids were on their own more. As a result of this, they started losing respect for adults because they were alone more. And they started looking to their peers a little bit more for guidance, which we all know how that goes. Also, schools were losing a lot of their power. They could no longer discipline children. But it just got worse. Well, not necessarily that. But in the 80s, pretty much the norm was all moms went back to work. And because of this, kids were getting more wild and less respectful of adults. The school's hands were tied at this point. There was all this new wave of parenting books coming out about being friends with your kids and, oh, don't say no to your children, that hurts their self-esteem. Could you imagine my parents saying that? Oh, I don't want to say no, do whatever you want. It just started to really shift. You're a good girl, even though you just kicked the cat across the room. You know, it was ridiculous, but this became the norm. So be friends with your kids. Now, the schools, of course, are losing more and more power. Not only that, they are being asked to do more parenting. So they had to start teaching kids about nutrition, about manners, even hygiene and sex. I thought that was appropriate, the hair gel she used, but I love that movie. So now the 90s are more of the 80s, but the big thing that really started to come in was computers. But back then they were big clunky things. Usually they were in a communal area where everyone could use them, and a lot of the gaming consoles came in. So what was happening here, parenting is going really downhill. They're not providing their children with leadership. Then the computers are starting to take over. If you don't provide your children with leadership, of course they're going to turn somewhere else. And they were going towards all these gaming things. The games that were on there were violent, so it just started from there. Now here's, you know, you look at a 12-year-old girl these days, and that's pretty much what she looks like. It's like you can't even, I feel sorry for men who are looking at women. I saw a guy the other day checking out this girl, and I said to him, you know, she's about 13 years old. And he went, no way, she's like 25. I said, no, she's like 13. I just saw her in school the other day. And so he's like running, you know, after that. But the big difference with this, now we've got the internet, and I remember when my kids were younger, I used to go to these school meetings at night where they'd say, here's how you block your kids from seeing all this horrible stuff on the internet. I was up the back laughing. I thought, are we ever going to be able to outsmart young people when it came to technology? Like, what are we thinking? I was the only one that wasn't going, oh yes, yeah. I was up the back going, this is useless. Useless. They're always going to be smarter than us, because to them it isn't technology, it's just like buttering toast. It's every day to them. But the big change was about 6 years ago when I talked to this girl. It coincided. It came with the smartphones. All of a sudden they had mobile technology. They were on the internet for everything. That's where they went, because they weren't going to their parents. So where are they going to go? They weren't going to the schools. They didn't trust adults. They didn't respect us. Oh, sorry about that really silly slide. I don't know what I was thinking. It was late when I did that. What am I, like grade four or something? Anyway, so what do all these decades have in common? Every single one of them, and probably before that too, is none of the parents were really talking to their kids about sex. None of them were. It was, you know, you get the odd family who would do that, but overall, it just wasn't discussed in families. I used to say to families, you know, when my kids were growing up, how do you talk to your kids about sex? Oh, I don't do that. Oh, it's just awkward. They go to school and learn that. Oh, it's just so awkward. So they don't seem to do that. Now, because I am a parenting coach, I talk to a lot of families. None of them were talking to their kids about sex. They say, oh, no, they had a guy talking about sex at their school the other day. Well, anyway, if they miss that day, they're going to miss that talk. And they've only got so much information they can pack into 2 hours. They do a very good job. I'm not putting them down. But they always have that, we all know what that is. They have a banana, and they're showing how you put the condom on the banana, you know. And then everyone laughs and gets awkward. And there's a lot of stuff that's missed, okay? So where are they going for information on sex? They're not talking to their parents. The sex speakers that come into schools are giving them minimal. Of course they're going to pornography. Every single parent that I've talked to of a teenager, I'll say, are they looking at porn? And every single parent says, I don't think so. No, I don't think so. And unfortunately, when I'm talking to their kids, it's all confidential. So I can't tell them. And here again, I'm glad it's not on video, because I'm going, you know, they told me that's all they do. They're up all night watching porn. This is what they're doing. The interesting thing that's happening, though, is that younger and younger children are doing this because they have older siblings who are doing this and watching porn. It's mobile. An older sibling will put down a phone and not have it locked, and there'll be like some porn thing on there. An 8-year-old will come along and go, woo, what's this? And then they don't have anyone to talk to because they know that's bad. They can't talk to mom and dad because no one does that, right? So they really are learning from pornography. How do I know they're watching porn? They tell me all the time. I'll even ask 8-year-olds, I say, what do you look at on the internet? And sometimes they'll tell me they've been watching, they call it sexy stuff. I don't think it's sexy. Okay, so they tell me they're watching porn. Now, what's interesting about this is when younger children see it, they haven't got a clue what they're looking at. And they think, and this is true, they think that's what mommy and daddy do. They think that that's exactly what mommy and daddy are doing. So there could be threesomes or orgies, or they've got this in their head that that is what's happening. Okay, now, you know where I'm going with this, right? I would say the age group that is bald are probably anywhere from right now, and it changes all the time. I'm trying to keep up with all this stuff, but they really are giving me a run for my money here. They are about 13 to 17, 18, 19. They're pretty much all bald. Now, not necessarily sexually active. I'll tell you a funny story. It's not a funny story. It's actually quite sad, but there's a little bit of humor in it. These parents hired me and they said, our poor boy is like suicidal, and you know, and that, I specialize in crisis. So I said, okay, well, what's, you know, I need to talk to him. Give me his Facebook page, blah, blah, blah. I organized a session with him. So I'm talking to him and I said, well, what happened, sweetie? I said, what's going on? You're, you know, and he says, I'm getting bullied at school. And I said, oh, I said, you know, that's terrible. Tell me what's going on. You know, take me through a day. And he says, well, it all started when he started in this new private boys' school, very nice area, and they were in the locker room or the change room, and they were getting changed, and everyone was bald except him. All the boys were bald. And they pointed at him and laughed, and the poor kid was labeled as hairy something. I can't remember what the second thing was. But this poor kid was ostracized and bullied because he wasn't shaving. Which, did we know this? Did... You know, I had no idea this stuff was going on. So that is a direct result of pornography. Where else do they get that idea from? Not the sex talker at school, not mom and dad. That's pornography. Okay, this is where it gets a little bit awkward for me because I'm a little bit uncomfortable sharing this stuff. This is the least of the, an example of the least disgusting party game that is very common. And it's called rainbow parties. I'm sure you've maybe heard of this. I looked it up in Wikipedia the other day and it said it's an urban legend. It's not. Kids are doing this. What the girls do, they'll go to a party. There's, of course, lots of drugs and alcohol involved. They'll either do their lips that way or they will layer them in different colors. Then they drag their mouth down the guy's penis, leaving a rainbow behind. If they don't do that, then they have to drink two or three shots. It's like a drinking game. Lots of fun, eh? Crazy, crazy. And that's one of the not so bad ones. I couldn't even repeat some of the other ones. Too embarrassing. Okay, so how do we redefine the norm and change the way future generations view sex? Now, I want to make it clear, not all kids are doing this, okay? But it is a norm, and I think it's only going to get worse. As a matter of fact, I know it is, because over the last 6 years, it's gotten worse and worse with my clients. So all we have to do is talk. We start talking about sex with our kids. Now, a lot of you here are younger, but you are the parents of tomorrow. You have to change what's going on. You have to talk to your kids about sex. It's always awkward. I'll tell you a funny story. Well, one story, then another one. One leads to the other. I have two kids. One, my oldest was three, my son. And he'd just seen a girl naked for the very first time that day. And I could see it in his face. He was really checking her out, and you know. So later on, and I knew I had a journal I used to write funny things in, so I knew it was going to come out that night. So he says to me, Mommy, boys and girls are different, right? And I'm trying not to go, yeah, but I just said, yeah. And he said, because boys have a bum in the back and a penis in the front. And I said, right. And he said, and girls have a bum in the back and a tiny little bum in the front. It's true, really. Anyway, I thought I better have a talk with this boy. So I said, well, okay, you know, these are your private parts. They're yours. You're not allowed to let anyone else touch them. You know, all the safety stuff. And then I said, but you can touch your private parts. That's perfectly normal. Everybody does it, but it's private. He said, without skipping a beat, do you do it too, Mommy? I said, want to bake some cookies? My daughter is actually here today, but 5 years later, she came to me, 3 years old, same conversation, and I said, da 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 da, it's private, everyone does it. She says, do you do it too, mommy? Now, I had an 8-year-old by this time. I had progressed, I had grown. So my response to her was, wanna bake some cookies? I couldn't deal with it. But my point with that is it's always going to be awkward and embarrassing. I'm not one of those people, even when I'm talking to teenagers, I don't think it should be blasé. I still think sex is, there's an element, if it's awkward to talk about it, it just is. It's just natural to feel that way. So when you are talking to kids, though, it's a little bit, there's a couple of rules that I tell my clients. And I say, when you're talking to kids, it's age appropriate. So a 3-year-old doesn't need to know the same things as a 13-year-old. And you just say to them, we'll discuss it when you're older, that's it, and then go bake some cookies, whatever. But also, you don't discuss your sex life. Your 3-year-old does not need to know what mommy and daddy are doing rolling around in the hay. It's just not necessary. They will ask questions, though. It's not appropriate. So in order to change the norm, I think we have to learn how to talk about it. And if you have to bake cookies, racks and racks of cookies, then do so. But don't let that stop you from discussing these things with your children. Thank you very much.